Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship. This evening we'll be using order of service number 2 on the pink sheets. And the 3 hymns are on the hymn board. We begin with 537. Please stand for singing. Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins,
God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed is he who comes as King, who comes in the name of the Lord.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
I will hear what the Lord God has to say.
A voice that speaks for peace.
Peace for all people and for his friends.
And those who turn to him in their hearts.
His help is near for those who fear him.
And his glory will live in our land.
Blessed is he who comes as King, who comes in the name of the Lord.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Please be seated. Now Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, I have gotten a man with the help of the Lord. And again she bore his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain a worker of the ground. In the course of time Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground, and Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering, but for Cain and his offering he had no regard. So Cain was very angry, and his face fell. The Lord said to Cain, why are you angry, and why has your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must rule over it. Cain spoke to his brother Abel, and when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel, your brother? He said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And the Lord said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground, and now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it shall no longer yield to you its strength. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, you have driven me today away from the ground, and away from your face I shall be hidden. I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. Then the Lord said to him, not so. If anyone kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord put a mark on Cain, lest any who found him should attack him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 5. Give ear to my words, O Lord, consider my groaning. Give attention to the sound of my cry, my King and my God, for to you do I pray. O Lord, in the morning you hear my voice. In the morning I prepare a sacrifice for you and watch. For you are not a God who delights in wickedness. Evil may not dwell with you. The boastful shall not stand before your eyes. You hate all evildoers. You destroy those who speak lies. The Lord abhors the bloodthirsty and deceitful man. But I, through the abundance of your steadfast love, will enter your house. I will bow down toward your holy temple in fear of you. Lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Make your way straight before me. For there is no truth in their mouth. Their inmost self is destruction. Their throat is an open grave. They flatter with their tongue. Make them bear their guilt, O God. Let them fall by their own counsels. Because of the abundance of their transgressions, cast them out. For they have rebelled against you. But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them ever sing for joy. And spread your protection over them. That those who love your name may exalt in you. For you bless the righteous, O Lord. You cover him with favor as with a shield. Our epistle lesson from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8 and 16 through 18. Paul writes, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing. At my first defense, no one came to stand by me, but all deserted me. May it not be charged against them. But the Lord stood by me and strengthened me, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed by it, and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil deed and bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 18th chapter, verses 9 through 17. Jesus also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, "God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all that I get." But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. Now they were bringing even infants to him that he might touch them. And when the disciples saw it, they rebuked them. But Jesus called them to him, saying, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our hymn of the day is number 729.
Thank you.
consideration is our gospel lesson from Luke chapter 18, where Jesus says, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." Last weekend we celebrated my 25th anniversary at Zion Lutheran Church. Actually, the anniversary is today, the 19th of October. Back in 1997, I was installed here at Zion. Last weekend, my family came to town for the event, and for those of you who've lost track, and I'm sure all of you have lost track, there are 19 people now in our family, plus two extra people came, a niece and her husband, for a total of 21 people, 15 adults, 6 children, 3 dogs, but I'm not going to be talking about that concern. All in all, it was quite an experience. It reminded me of one thing that I've learned many times in my life, and that is that children are different than adults. Now, before you start thinking to yourself, well, that's obvious, just look at them, I mean, they're noticeably different. They aren't just small adults. One way in which children are different is in the area of knowledge. They don't seem to understand things that I think are pretty obvious. For instance, it would be nice if young children knew that when they're tired and grumpy, that taking a nap would feel good and help them out a lot. They don't seem to know that. Sometimes I'm also reminded that they don't seem to know how stairs work. And they go to the top of the stairs and they just keep walking straight and into the abyss. The only stairs in our house are down to the basement, so it's a little bit of a trip and it's cement at the bottom. So we keep the door closed most of the time when there's children in the house because they just don't get it. Children are also quite different in their emotions. They almost never hide their emotions, which of course makes them quite different than adults, because we spend a good deal of time hiding ours, don't we? They seem to get emotional over strange things. They have an irrational fear of their parents leaving, even if it's just leaving the room for a moment. And they throw fits over silly things. I've seen children throw fits over Mom cutting the sandwich the wrong direction. Do you cut it straight so it's two rectangles, or do you cut it diagonal so it's two triangles? Well, I've maybe struck a nerve here. Maybe some of you are concerned about how your sandwich is cut. Sorry about that. But it's a challenging thing. They'll throw a fit if you grab the wrong toy off the shelf. A friend of ours recently put on Facebook that her 2-year-old was throwing a fit because she had put on the pants that he had picked out for the day. Of course, children are noticeably different physically, and I don't just mean that they're smaller than we are. In fact, I have a grandson who's quite a bit taller than I am. Maybe you've noticed that too. But kids have a different physical makeup than we do, don't they? They seem to have endless energy, and they keep going, and they keep going beyond what you would think they could, until they lay still, and then they fall asleep just like that. That's not quite how I'm put together anymore. And they aren't easily injured. Last weekend, I saw grandchildren take several falls that probably would have put me in the hospital, but they just got up and went to where they were going and kept playing, even when they do get hurt, which is rare, they seem to easily heal. Their cuts and bruises and sprains and strains seem to be gone in an instant compared to mine. Children are just different than us. Certainly Jesus knew the differences. To start with, he created them. Nobody knows children like God knows children. In fact, he's the only one who truly understands them. In addition to that, Jesus lived as a child. One of the Bible verses that I memorized when I was a kid, I didn't really understand very well at the time, but it was Luke chapter 2, verse 40, and Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. I still know it. Now I understand it a little bit because it says Jesus grew as a child and he gained wisdom and he had interactions with adults and he was a kid, just like we were one day. So Jesus knew exactly what he was saying when he said, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." That is our gospel this evening. And we've heard it plenty of times. We've read it in our Bibles. Maybe we've even discussed it in a Bible class from time to time. But what does it mean? Do you know what he's saying? I'm not entirely sure I do, honestly. I don't presume to fully understand God or what he says. Ever. But I have some thoughts on this text for your consideration this evening. I think he's talking about the knowledge of a child. As adults, we think that we know far too much. We tend not to believe the things that the Bible says if we don't really understand those things. I'm told that when William and Catherine Booth founded the Salvation Army back in 1865, they chose not to have any sacraments in their church because they didn't think that we human beings could understand baptism and the sacrament of the altar. Well, I think they're right in saying we can't understand those things because we don't fully understand those things, but we do them because the Bible tells us to do them, even if we don't understand them. That's thinking like a child. Adults tend to second-guess God, blame him for things in our lives, even try to rewrite his law. Children would be more inclined to accept what is said to them as true. Entering the kingdom means accepting God's word as true, even if we don't understand it or don't like it. I think Jesus is talking about the emotion of a child. As adults, we tend to forget the good news of Jesus Christ. We get grumpy and legalistic, and we judge other people rather than joyfully celebrating the gospel that has been given to us. The great Christian author C.S. Lewis was once asked why he, a professor and department chairman at Oxford and Cambridge universities in England, would write children's books. He had just written the books that we know as the Chronicles of Narnia, children's fantasy books. Lewis answered that he had written them so that we could remember the joy of the risen Christ and the forgiveness of sins. He wrote them to give us all the joy that children know when first hearing about Jesus. I think also when Jesus says that we should follow him like children, that there is some reference to the physical resilience of a child. The Bible encourages us as Christians to be strong and courageous. We were not given a spirit of fear. Paul wrote that we should take up the whole armor of God, that we may be able to withstand to the evil day, to fasten on the belt of truth and to put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace, take up the shield of faith, he says, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. In short, he says, do battle. Put on the armor of Christ. Empowered by his forgiveness, strengthened by the water of baptism, and by the body and blood of Christ in the sacrament, don't back down and don't worry about getting hurt. Jesus is a physical Savior, and we are his body, the church. Finally, I believe that God wants us to pray like a child. They don't try to sort out in their mind what they should pray for or shouldn't. They just ask God what they want to ask him. And they tell him what they want to tell him. They don't use big fancy church words. They just speak the language that they know. Jesus uses the example of the tax collector in his parable who offers the simple prayer, God be merciful to me, a sinner. That's how we pray. So set aside your pride and your pretenses and your adult inhibitions and serve Christ like a child would. Know the joy of his gospel. Bring him the thoughts and desires of your heart. Do battle with the devil and anxiously await that day when he will return for us all. Amen. We confess our faith with the Apostles' Creed. Please stand as we say it together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and all people according to their needs. Almighty Father, we come to you at the gracious invitation of your Son. May we receive your gifts as little children, that no rebuke of our sinful flesh, the world, or the devil would deter us from turning to you in repentance. Grant us humility to pray, God be merciful to me, a sinner. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be merciful to your church here and in every place. Defend our pastors from arrogance and pride, and strengthen them in the faithful preaching of your word, that both your holy law and your precious gospel would be proclaimed, and your children be united in saving faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As your Son welcomed infants, give us a deep care for the children entrusted to us, that we would defend their lives even before birth. Instill in parents a desire and commitment to bring their little children to Jesus. Use our Lutheran school, our Sunday school, our Bible classes and youth classes to preserve them in the faith. Teach each of us in humility to receive the kingdom of God like a little child. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
O Lord, you do not delight in wickedness or let the boastful stand before you. Give the leaders of the nations wisdom to govern in accordance with your will. Keep them mindful of the stewardship that they hold on behalf of others, that they may fulfill their duties with diligence and humility. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
God of mercy, we praise you that you deliver our souls from death and our feet from falling. Care for those who are near death, preserve them from despair, and give them a confident hope in the resurrection promises of our risen Lord. Come to the aid of everyone in need. We name them now. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
O Lord, if we trust in ourselves for righteousness, we are lost and dead in our sins. Yet you mercifully draw us to yourself in repentance and hear the cries of those who trust in your Son. Grant us humility that we may not exalt ourselves or treat our brothers and sisters with contempt. Rescue us from every evil and bring us into your kingdom as your beloved children. To you alone be all glory, O Father, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Services every Sunday at 9 o'clock in the morning, and of course this Wednesday service at 7. A week from Sunday, on the 30th of October, after our Sunday morning service, we'll be having a voters meeting where we will be electing people for our council and approving a budget for 2023. It's a pretty important meeting, so if you're able, please come and cast your votes on that day, which is kind of ironically just a couple of days before our nation's election day, isn't it?
No,
that's the following week? All right. So you don't get the two elections confused. The council is on the 30th, and then sometime in November we're electing a whole bunch of other people too. On the 29th, we have our annual chili feed. If you'd like to bring some chili, we'd be happy to receive your chili, and if you'd like, we'll even judge it and put you up against others' chilies and to see whose is the best. Every year I strive to find better judges who will recognize the true quality of my chili. You know, I've been doing it how long? Have I been cooking chili for like 12 years for this contest? I have not won it yet, but I am going to persevere. I will be in the contest once again this year with my chili, which is delicious, by the way, isn't it, Linda? Yes, it is. Katie, are you entering the chili cooking contest this year?
Yeah.
Good. I'm so happy to hear that. Anyway, that is the chili feed is on the 29th, which is a Saturday. It's from 5 to 6:30 right here at church. And if you're interested in tickets, I don't know, do we have tickets around here someplace? We could find you a ticket. If you're interested in buying a ticket tonight, talk to Linda or Katie. They both said yes, so they must know something I don't. And they can get you a ticket. But we look forward to that. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.